I think so. Where one curious question that I have in mind is, you know, you had very, you know, what is it, different backgrounds in dancing, in your education. You have got a very interesting education in English literature, and then you're also a multilingualist. That is where you can speak different languages, not just English, and you're I think native language, but also Bengali and things like that. So do you think all these have come together to shape you up as a very professional storyteller? And therefore, let me also put it this way, that do you think if somebody wants to be a storyteller, do they have to be, you know, well-versed, or let's say baptized into all this set of skills?
Right, very interesting question, Nagendra. For me, it's certainly true. I do have a background in the study of literature, so I understand language. I can understand text, subtext, and other elements of it. So those are things that I'm very sensitive to when I tell stories, or when I even read stories or receive stories in any way. Yes, a training in radio, a training in dance, all of that makes me naturally far more expressive in a certain sense. Having said that, I do not see that as a requirement. You know, the primary requirement to be a fine storyteller is the want to be a storyteller, the want to be a fine storyteller, and to be able to translate your experiences into a narrative framework, and to be able to reach out with that framework. So there are storytellers who will just sit and tell stories. There are storytellers like me who sing a little, dance a little, and then are quite animated in their storytelling. There are storytellers who even have gymnastics and acrobatics as part of their storytelling. So they will jump over the place, and they use
all over the place.
Yeah, all over the place, literally. That's not my style. And maybe singing and dancing is not someone else's style, which does not mean you cannot be a fine storyteller. Okay. For me, yes, it has shaped the way I share, and it's something I believe in intrinsically. I actually believe each one of us should sing, dance, read, write poetry, whether we can or we can't. Okay. And storytelling gives me that space.
So therefore, if I have to understand you in a different way, is it that, you know, all these forms are, just know what he said, are different forms of expression than, you know, pursue, career pursuit kind of thing?
Yes.
The dancing or singing or let's say studying or doing, pursuing any music for that matter?
Right.
So do you think these are all different forms of self-expression?
Absolutely. Right. Absolutely. They are different forms of self-expression, and they are very, very essential. Yeah. We've lost it. Unfortunately, we've lost it. You know, there's a beautiful saying that if you go to any shaman anywhere in the world, the shaman will first ask you, when is it you stop singing? When is it you stop dancing? When is it that you stop being enchanted by stories? And when is it that you stopped enjoying the silence of being alone?
Right.
And we've lost all of these, you know. This is what shamans are telling us to go back to. Sing, dance, listen to stories, and just enjoy yourself, and you'll be fine. You're not going to be depressed or sad.
Great. Now let's come to in the last couple, I think maybe about 7 years now, since 2008 to now, I think you have started off with the storytelling with the children, right? So which you continue even now. So what is it like when you do the storytelling session or a workshop with the children, with parents, let's say adults, and let's say with people from corporate houses? So what kind of difference do you find between these three set of people? Because I think each one is expected to react in one way to your workshop, that's one. And also from your point of view, I'm sure since you have done a lot of linguistics and all, the little background in learning as well, each one of us receives or learns in our own way, right? So, from your experience for almost about 7 years now, so do you find any different styles that that are applicable more favorably with the children and more favorably with the parents, or let's say adults kind of thing, and then people from company companies, or let's say corporate executives?
So I would say with children, they are far more open. They are less inhibited. They haven't yet got boxed and labeled with years and years of education and societal implications of who they should be and who they shouldn't be. They have far less concerns. So they open up a lot more easily, which means I can also take the liberty of tomfoolery and of music and dance and other elements much more with them.
They are with you.
Yeah. Yeah, with children, and of course they're delighted, they're terribly delighted to respond to that. I mean, the education system does not give them space, unfortunately. You have those separate hours when there is some extracurricular activity happening perhaps, but otherwise they do not have the space, so they love it. Yeah, in fact, in my sessions, children lie down. There are children who are just rolling over and listening, and I'm perfectly fine with that. And when they say, hey, teacher will say something, teacher will say nothing. It's just fine. Just go ahead and do that. So they let go. They open up a lot more. And since storytelling is, in a sense, conversing with another person, they feel very acknowledged. So children come up and share lots of secrets with me. So right. Parents, be wary when you send your children for my workshops. So it's very easy for us to break ice, for me to help them open up. Yeah. I work a lot with teachers in the adults group. I work a lot with teachers. So the teacher group is a different ballgame. One would assume that all of them open up easily, which is, I would say, 50% true. Teachers do open up far more easily than those who are not working with children. I think by virtue of working with children, they still retain a lot of their childlike enthusiasm. They connect with what it is to be childlike. They are more receptive, they're a little more open. And they do see the point. Because with teachers, my focus is on how they can be better teachers in the classroom using stories.
That is immaterial. It is, in other words, it is, it's immaterial which subject you're teaching, if I'm right. You can be a great storyteller even if you're teaching physics, or it's a science, or social, or geography, or physics, whatever it is. I mean, any subject, use as for what your knowledge says that they can be good at storytelling, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Very good.
So you could be telling the story of a banana, of how it journeyed through the mouth and into these 32 crushing things and with some fluid inside it, and it was stuck and then it became paste as a science teacher. And storytelling need not necessarily be the concept. For example, you could just tell the story of a mathematician before you start your class on a particular concept.
Okay.
It need not necessarily be the concept itself. It could be a trigger to generate curiosity, to generate interest. It could be the hook for bringing the child. So teachers, to a certain extent, are receptive. To a great extent, I would say. I've had very experienced teachers with 25, 30 years of experience come up and say, this is wonderful. This is a new learning for me. So teachers are very receptive. Corporate, it's been, I would say, black and white in terms of the response. A lot of them aren't as yet prepared. And there is a tendency to accept something which comes from a position of authority. Yeah, so maybe someone in the corporate is telling you that this will work. Then they're going to take it far more seriously. But those who do, the workshops that I've done, those who do are completely bowled over. And they believe that this is something that has to reach out. And this is the kind of lateral thinking that one requires. And
what kind of executives did you actually come across in these workshops? Is it from entry-level executives or mid-level executives? Or is it senior-level executives? Because that tells us the story of who is interested in this very art of storytelling, as well as also somebody who has the vision to see the power of storytelling as to how they can connect better with not just the colleagues, but the peers and the bosses and the subordinates, but also the customers. I mean, that's where you need to have the skill. So what kind of executives did you come across in your workshops?
So in my open workshops, by and large, there aren't anyone from the very senior rung who have as yet come, though they have wanted to and have expressed interest. I guess they're very busy people. By and large, I have not had them come, but I've had very senior executives put me onto projects where I work with a group from their firm, from their organization. So in a sense, I would say I've interacted more with the initial
side. Yeah.
right?